Well, thanks for coming. Just a couple quick comments as we finished our second bye week in 3 or 4 weeks, which is unusual. We have to somehow, I felt like our team had a lot of momentum after the Maryland game to go on the road and to play like that. I thought our, don't normally give too much credit to our staff, but I think our assistant coaches did a great job of getting a group ready to go play a noon game on the road and against a talented team. So we got to somehow restake that momentum. This is a little bit uncharted waters for myself to have this many bye weeks this early in the season. So we got to get ready to go. That means we got to crank it up today against a team that their last game was a tremendous effort by their quarterback. Threw for 400 yards. Their defense played well, and obviously an incredible environment at Rutgers. So we just got to be ready to go, and I'm sure we will. We're a young team that's getting older, and you'd expect that, but you'd anticipate that, but sometimes that doesn't happen. So I think you see a lot of maturity starting to occur. You see, someone told me in the last 5 interceptions, 4 have been by freshmen. You see a freshman quarterback that's playing very well. You see young receivers starting to develop, and so there's some in an offensive line that's starting to solidify themselves. We certainly have areas of weakness that we're working on, I enjoy coaching this team right now, and I know our staff does too. I'll answer any questions.
Front row, Bill. What did you do specifically as a coaching staff to ensure that the momentum will not be stalled?
We haven't done it yet. I mean, that's what this week's for. Last week, we kind of have a standard operating procedure for what we do on Thursday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. But this is, I'm going to have a team meeting today and discuss it with them. Good thing is if you have a bad team and guys that don't quite listen to you, then you have to create things. I'm going to talk to them like grown men and say, this is where we're at. This is what we have to do. You've had 3 days off. Let's pick up and go. And I'm anticipating that they'll answer. That's why we're having a team meeting. I want to look them in the eyes and say, this is where we're at, what we need to have happen.
And just in the general sense, I don't know how much you were able to watch the rest of college football. The landscape's changing seemingly every week. How do you feel you guys fit into that right now?
Well, you have a better idea because you get to watch it now. If you asked me several weeks ago, I had no idea. I like our team. We're certainly nowhere near where we will end up, in my opinion. We're still growing and getting better. We're a much better team than we were 2 weeks ago. And that's just because you're getting the game reps, game experience. But by all means, there's no answers in this room. And the good thing is our players know that. In my opinion, we need much more depth in our defensive line. There's 4 or 5 guys that aren't playing. You got Chris Carter and Munger and Shutt and Mike Hill and those guys. It's time to contribute a little bit, and we're going to put a lot of pressure on those guys this week.
Front row, Todd.
Urban, if you look at your offense and guys like JT and Michael Thomas and Ezekiel Elliott and Dontre, these are all guys that you recruited and guys that you developed. Is this offense starting to look like that fast offense that you want here, and in other words, almost created in the image that you want it to be?
Well, last year's offense was kind of the way we wanted it too. It's just you have to adapt to the personnel you have. You have a 235, 240 pound tailback and a line like we had, and the quarterback we had, Braxton. So it was, I think what we do well, our offensive staff, is we adapt to the personnel. I've been asked that question, is this the vision that we have? I'd like to have really fast players that create big plays. We're kind of developing that right now, but I don't mind having what we had last year either. You have good checkers to work with. As long as there's good quality players to work with, which you should always have at Ohio State, it's up to the offensive staff to develop the plan around those players. And I think our guys have done a really good job. Much different offense than I talked to Coach Holtz briefly, and he said it's a much different offense now than it was last year. And it's because there's a void, and we're using skill. Zeke Elliott's a little different player than Carlos was. And you got Dontre and Jalen are starting to develop that gives you a little more flexibility on the perimeter run game, too.
If you were going into an overtime game and had the option to put your offense or defense on the field first, which one would you go with?
Well, you always go defense first, just to evaluate. Overtime game?
Yeah.
Yeah, always go defense first.
Far left, Rusty.
Urban, I know none of your players have played Rutgers. Rutgers haven't played you guys either. Is there, from a coaching standpoint, is it easier when nobody has any preconceived notions, they don't know the program, they don't know the personnel necessarily, or does it make a difference at all?
I've never thought of it that way. I don't think it makes a bit of difference. I think nowadays with all this technology that you have, they're going to be watching hours upon hours of film. So I don't believe that's that big of a deal. You know, I think what caught their eye was what they did last week. That really caught their eye. And to see people storm the field, and it caught my eye, and I was watching the end of that thing. So, our guys will really prepare for this game, I can tell you that. But I don't, whether we've never played them before, I don't think that matters.
Another quick question. Are you aware of, Mississippi and Mississippi State have moved up into the national consciousness with number one and what they've done in the last few weeks? Obviously, you have some ties there. I just wondered if you had any comments just about
I voted Mississippi State number one. You know, what they've done, and it's first chance I had a really chance to watch them. And that was in between volleyball sets. But, wow. I mean, three top 10 wins, and I talked to their coach, who's a great friend of mine, and that's spectacular. So I think they earned it what they've done.
Coach, you have 23 scholarship true freshmen on your roster. 10 of them have played. 13 of them have not played yet. Is that kind of the sweet spot? Is that kind of where you want it?
No, you like more. I like more to play. You know, I think we could play Sam Hubbard. It's not his decision. I mean, if his decision, he'd be playing. He's working hard enough to play. He's just pulling the trigger and putting him in that game. It certainly could help us, but a guy like that, you just don't want to play a handful of snaps. You want him to play. But you'd like to, you know, about four or five more, if we could get him in there and play, it's kind of like where we'd like to be.
Far left, Doug. Urban, you guys have talked about the red zone offense a couple times this year. You were so good at it the first 2 years. Is there anything that's the reason? I mean, it's still pretty good, but not
it's
well
not very good. No, it's not. It's for what we expect. It's not good. It's something that teams. There's a couple styles that teams are starting to play us, and we gotta not. It's not the players' fault. It's our fault. It's coaching errors that we're trying to. Whether it be tempo, whether it be, you know, we just have to do a better job. And we worked hard last week on tomorrow's going to be tomorrow and Wednesday will be those situations again to force us to call plays that. Block those numbers because people are just, you know, I mean, everybody's within a yard of the ball. And a lot of times in tempo, when we first started doing it, they couldn't get lined up and we'd mush them in for 1 or 2 yards, and that's not happening now.
And in your career, when you have a team that does lose early versus teams that the first two seasons here and other times in your career where you're running through undefeated, does it change anything about how you coach the guys at all? Does it change anything just about the feel of the season when you have an early loss versus when you still have that no losses yet?
We're just day to day. I don't really remember. You know, as you were talking, I'm trying to think of back in the years ago what's happened, and it has no bearing. It depends what kind of team you have. This was a unique experience. This is an extremely young team that got hit in the face in training camp with some injuries. You know, I didn't have two of my offensive captains weren't playing, and so that was a unique challenge. And the cool thing is you had a redshirt freshman quarterback grow up right in front of our eyes. You saw Nick Vinette start to grow up and be the tight end until Jeff got back, and now we can play them both. You saw Mike Thomas grow up. So you got to give credit to some guys that were non-factors, absolutely non-factors a year ago, are having an impact on this team right now. And that's a credit to them. And when a teammate goes down or you're struggling, someone has to step up, and we witnessed that right before our eyes.
Urban, speaking of the youth you mentioned earlier, 13 of your 24 starters are freshman or sophomore. By that measure, the youngest team in the Big Ten. Can you recall one of your teams being this young? And what's kind of maybe fun about coaching a team like this?
Yeah, I think the 07, if I remember 07, it was a very young team. And you said 13 of the 24 are
freshman or sophomore.
Well, that's a good sign for the future here. You know, I knew we were young. I didn't look at that number before.
Necessarily seem to be the case even if the yards aren't the same. Is that your assessment? Is it still as much a factor in your offense as you envision?
Well, Braxton gave us the wow factor, and it would take one at any time. You saw, you know, a couple times last year, 70 yards, 60 yards, and I don't know if JT, I do know JT really, that's not kind of his game. He's a move-the-chain quarterback, which is fine. So we have to get those big plays elsewhere, and we kind of are. You know, we're not, The thing is, teams are forcing us in our run game to stop the run, so they're loading the box and take the shots down the field. We're starting to hit them now, which is encouraging. And that's where the Dontre and Zeke and Jalen Marshall and we get Curtis Samuel back, which we should get him back this week. Those are the guys that have to, because you can't play offense. Defenses are too good. You have to have some hits somewhere. You know, you saw Jeff Hyreman go up and make a big play. So we got some big play weapons. And Braxton, remember when we first got here, that was the big play weapon was Braxton right, and then to change it up, we go Braxton left. And now there, you don't have to do that. I feel better about the skill positions.
It seems like he makes the right read more often than not. So even if he doesn't do a home run, he's at least.
Yeah, very. Yeah, he played very well. That's very observant. He a lot of those reads were, I mean, they're split second reads, and he made the right decision, gained his 12, 14 yards, move the chains, and get going. And that's the kind of guy he is.
And final couple questions, front row here, Tim.
Urban, you talked about right after the Maryland game, addressing some things still in your pass defense. What did you guys, I guess, discuss over the last week about a few guys still getting out of the gate? I'm talking about, you know, receivers, et cetera.
Yeah, well, you just when a situation shows up, you have to ask the why. And we found out there's a signal issue on one of them, that big play against Cam Burrows, and I don't want to show it to you, but it was a very similar signal, so we changed the signal. You know, if it's a personnel issue, you have to look at changing personnel. I think our personnel is kind of hanging in there now. And that's the last 2 weeks we faced very, very good receivers. Gave up some big plays. We're going to face two good receivers again this week. So the options are, number one, which I think you know the answer, continue to work and improve and enhance the abilities of our players. The other was implode it and start over again. And no, we're not. We're nowhere near there. We're actually pretty pleased with where we're at. Just, you know, we can't have guys get cut loose, and so we've addressed those.
Yeah, thing, you know, you just touched on a minute. Curtis Samuel's going to be back this week and stuff. How does he sort of like blend in now again? I mean, you know,
Rod Smith's going to. Yeah. He's in a street fight not to let him blend in. And the one thing that Coach Drayton's really developed. I mean, you watch those kids on special teams now. You watch their involvement in the program, and done a very nice job. That's if not the strongest unit, one of them. And I'm anxious to watch.
Has Rod been a bonus?
Oh yeah, he was 88 out the gate. In spring, no, not in factor. When I was getting ready for training camp, there was part of me saying he probably won't have a back. Not he's a bad guy, just really struggled academically and just didn't do much. And he's been a pleasure to coach. His demeanor, his work ethic, I really like where he's at.
Final